Hello everybody! Today we are going to explore the point estimation of parametric models. It is very important and strictly connected to hypothesis testing and confidence interval, so don't miss the video. I need to use some basic concepts of probability and inferential statistics, so if you don't feel comfortable with them, check out my previous videos. I leave you the links in the top right corner. So let's start with the topic of today. The situation in which we want to apply point estimation is the one described in the video of inferential statistics. Let's recall it. So we are studying a random phenomenon, an event whose outcome cannot be predicted a priori, and thanks to our knowledge about this event, we have defined a one parametric model for the random variable we are interested in. It means that we know the formulation of the distribution of the random variable except for an unknown parameter theta. The parametric model, then, can be indicated with fx theta, where theta belongs to a subset of the real numbers, and f indicates the distribution of the random variable. The assumption we make is that the distribution of our random variable belongs to this set. It means that there exists a theta 0, such that fx theta 0 is the distribution of x. Keep in mind the role of this theta 0. As always, fx theta is the mass function or density function, depending whatever we are in the discrete or continuous case. Let's see two important examples. For the discrete case, we can consider as random experiment the result of throwing a coin, and as random variable the function that takes the value of 1 for the head and 0 for the tail. If we indicate with p the probability of getting a head, we can write the mass function as on the slide. We indicate the model with Bernoulli P, with P between 0 and 1. For the continuous case, we consider as random phenomenon the heights of men in Canada. From previous studies of heights, we know that the distribution is normal, and for simplicity we assume also to know the variance. The density function is the formula on the screen, and we indicate the parametric model with n mu sigma square, where mu is the unknown parameter and is the mean of the distribution. So, the problem of today is the following. How can we find a known parameter theta 0? Or better said, how can we give an estimation of it? What we have to do is to collect a sample from the event and then try to estimate it. Indeed, we cannot measure the eyes of all men in Canada or trying to throw the coin an infinite number of times. So, we must be satisfied just with a sample and an estimation. For example, we can throw a coin 100 times and writing down how many heads and tails we get. Then we make our guess about the probability of getting a head with this particular coin. Similarly, in the example of the height, we can consider the heights of 10,000 men and give an estimation for the average height of men in Canada. Now we are going to see the theory that allows us to answer this question, and in general to find an estimation for all parametric models. Remember that when we are studying a sample from an experiment, you use the notation on the slide. Indeed, every repetition of the experiment is a random variable, and all the repetitions are independent and follow with the same distribution fx theta. Since we need to use a sample to guess the value of the parameter, what we need is a function, say tn, which goes from our sample space to the n, which represents all the values that my sample can take, to the parameter space, theta capital, so the subset of values that our parameter can take. Every such function is called point estimator. So, in the real case scenario, we give an input to the function the actual values we have collected, and we get a number that will be our estimation. For simplicity, we will write theta hat n instead of tn evaluated in x1 xn. For the example of the coin, since the probability of getting a head is equal to the mean of the distribution, we can take as the estimator of the parameter p the intuitive one, that is the sample mean. Note that it is again a random variable, whose distribution will depend on p, since the distribution of xi depends on p. In general, we have to remember that the point estimator theta hat n is a random variable whose distribution depends on the parameter theta. So we have that a point estimator can be any function from the sample to theta capital. How can we know which functions are the best one to provide an estimation? Of course, a good estimator will be one whose values will be concentrated around theta, if we assume that our sample comes from the distribution fx theta. An easy way to look at this problem is to consider the mean and the variance of the estimator. Indeed, we want the mean to be equal to theta, or as close as possible, and the dispersion around the mean that we can capture with the variance to be as small as possible. This explains why the mean square error, that now we are going to define, is considered a good measurement. Note that since we don't know the value of theta 0 associated to our phenomenon, we have to ask the estimator to work well for every value that theta can take, namely for all the associated distribution fx theta. Let us see how the mean square error is defined. Since it is not important to know the size of the sample, I will indicate the point estimator just with theta hat. The mean square error between the point estimator and theta is the expected value of the square difference between theta hat and theta. It makes sense because the idea is to look at the average difference between the estimation and the parameter. Notice that the difference will depend on the sample we collect, so it might be that for some specific sample, the estimation works very well and for others don't. To have an overall idea, we consider the mean. It is interesting that we can write this error as the sum of two positive quantities. The first one is the bias square, where the bias is the difference between the mean of theta hat and theta. And as we said before, we want this to be as close as possible to zero. The second is the variance of the estimator theta hat, and we say that we want also this to be as small as possible. In conclusion, we should aim to minimize the mean square error in order to find a good estimator. An important definition is that an estimator is called unbiased if its bias is zero, so the mean of the point estimator theta hat is theta. Now we have a measurement of the goodness of an estimator. So if we have two estimators, we can say which is the best between them, that is the one with the lowest mean square error. However, how can we know that we have achieved the smallest error possible for an estimator? In general, we cannot know this, but we have a quite useful result that we can apply under some condition on the parametric model. This is the Kramer-Rao lower bound. It says that the variance of the estimator should be greater or equal to a quantity that depends on the bias, the size of the sample, and another quantity called Fisher information, indicated by I theta. For today, the important thing to remember is that if the estimator is unbiased, then the mean square error is equal to the variance, and its variance is at least n times the Fisher information to the minus 1. Indeed, the derivative in the above expression is equal to 0. So, if we are just interested in an unbiased estimator and we find one with variance n times the Fisher information to the minus 1, we have found an optimal one in terms of mean square error. Indeed, it doesn't exist an unbiased estimator with lower mean square error. Now it is time to see an example of a point estimator, or more precisely, how we can get one using the method of the maximum likelihood. First, we need the concept of likelihood. We define the likelihood of theta on the basis of the sample x1, xn to be the product of the probability mass function in the discrete case or density function in the continuous case of the random variable x1, xn. In the example of the coin, we get that the likelihood is the formula you can see on the slide. Note, by definition, in the discrete case, L theta is exactly the probability of observing the sample x1, xn, because it is the product of the probability of observing each observation in the sample. Notice that, for the same sample, we will get different values of the likelihood if we consider different values of p, as you can see on the slide. So, there are values of p that makes more probable to observe this sample respect to others. This interpretation of the likelihood in a discrete case justifies the following definition. If there exists a value for our parameter such that its likelihood is greater or equal than the likelihood of the other possible values of the parameter, we take that value as point estimator of the parameter, and it is called a maximum likelihood estimator for theta. Note that it is a point estimator because it is a function from the sample to the parameter space. Let's see this with the example of the coin. On the previous slide, we have found this expression for the likelihood. Now, in order to find a maximum of the function LP, it is easier to look at the logarithmic of this function, the so-called log likelihood. The reason is that the products are transforming sums, and this makes the calculation easier. The maximum are the same, since the log is a monotonic function. After having calculated the log likelihood, we look at the zero of its derivative to find the maximums. We found just one root, that is the sample mean. And since the second derivative is non-positive, we know that we have found the unique maximum of this function. Hence, we have just found the maximum likelihood estimator for the parameter p. Now, let's see how good this estimator is. Since the estimator is 1 over n times the binomial with parameters n and p, it is easy to see that its mean is exactly p. So, it is an unbiased estimator. And it can be calculated that its variance is equal to the Kramer-Rau lower bound. Therefore, we have found a very good estimator. So, in the example of the beginning, where we threw a coin 100 times, we can use as estimator the sample mean, that in this case is 0.7. And we know that, given the data we have, it is basically the best estimation we can get. Also, in the case of the normal distribution, we found that the sample mean is the maximum likelihood estimator for the mean. It is unbiased, with variance equal to the Kramer-Rau lower bound. Then, for the example of the heights of men that we saw before, we can calculate the sample mean to have a good estimation. In both cases, using the method of the maximum likelihood, we have found estimators with the possible lowest mean square error among the unbiased estimator. Now we can wonder if it is a coincidence or it is always like this. Actually, we cannot say that for every distribution the maximum likelihood estimator behaves so well, but there is an interesting result that tells us that for some distributions belonging to the exponential families, the maximum likelihood estimator behaves asymptotically well. That is, for large n, we have that the distribution of the maximum likelihood estimator can be approximated by a normal with mean theta and variance equal to the Kramer-Rau lower bound. So the maximum likelihood estimator has a behavior close to the optimal one. This explains why it is a very important estimator. This is all for this video. Let us recap what we have learned today. We have defined what a point estimator is. We have seen how to measure the goodness of the estimator looking at the mean squared error. We have introduced the Kramer-Rau lower bound. And finally, we have defined the maximum likelihood estimator, and we have seen why it is so important. Even if it is all for this video, there are other important questions related to the parameter that we need to answer. Indeed, instead of knowing the exact value of the parameter, we could just be interested to know if it belongs or not to a specific subset of the parametric space. This is the so-called hypothesis testing. Or instead to know the exact value of the parameter, since it could be quite hard to get only with a sample, it would be more interesting to find an interval which is likely to contain a parameter. It is the so-called confidence interval. So don't miss the next videos where we are going to explore these topics. Thank you a lot to have spent this time with me. Don't forget to smash the like button, subscribe to the channel, and let me know what do you think on the comments.